All of us in the 70s were blessed with the existence of a club on the Upper West Side called McKell's. And they had a house band there that was, sort of like a soul heaven. Richard T., Cornell Dupree, Eric Gale, Steve Gadd, Chris Parker, Gordon Edwards was the leader, and they were called, they later recorded under the name Stuff. But initially they were just guys that were playing R&B every night at McKell's, and there was a certain group of musicians that hung around up there. And Hiram was one of them, and I was one of them. And that's actually where we met. And then I remember Hiram appearing on, I guess he started working with Phoebe Snow. And he appeared on Saturday Night Live. I was in the house band. Phoebe sang with the house band, but with the addition of two background singers, one of which was Hiram. Not playing guitar then, just singing background for Phoebe Snow. But a lot of hip action, I'll tell you. When he sang, he put everything he had into it. So that was, and those were the first two times that I remember seeing Hiram. And then I would just see him around, because at that time, we had a thing called studio work that musicians would do. It's disappeared now, at least from my group, but where you would just, there were constantly were records being made with studio bands and commercials as well. And that it was possible to make a living that way, and both Hiram and I were kind of making a living that way. I did, for a couple of years, certainly, between my runs on Saturday Night Live and then the Dave Letterman show starting. And so we became friends in that way. Then, of course, some of the studio cats that I knew put together a band, the 24th Street Band. Hiram, Will Lee, eventually, because they had some other bass players, and Steve Jordan, and Clifford Carter on the keyboards. And they had a great following among the musicians and cognoscenti of New York. But in Japan, they had an even bigger following, a more far-reaching, less esoteric. So they sold records in Japan, and I was friends with all three of them, and they brought me in to co-produce a record for them. And that's where we really locked in, Hiram and me. And sometimes I would, as an arranger, call Hiram to play on other projects that I was doing. He could play any, and by any, I really, this is not a euphemism for anything. This is just literally any style. You want to talk about, bubblegum music from the 60s? You want to talk about Jimi Hendrix, of course. You want to talk about King Sonny a Day to Cornell Dupree, to any reference you would give him. Donny Hathaway, whatever it was. The Brecker Brothers. He was so well-versed in the music of the day and would give you anything in the studio, literally anything. So when it came time and I got this job on the David Letterman show and I needed a band, and especially, in particular, a four-piece band, it was very natural for me, having just finished that album, to hire, and I wish I could have hired Cliff, but I was only allowed four pieces. So I could only have one keyboard, but I hired Will and Steve and Hiram, who took the television, the world of late night television by storm. That band, spearheaded by Hiram, and the way he could play rock guitar with it, you know, I mean, with the hippest of jazz feeling added to it, you know, schooled musicians just jamming and getting off, had never been seen on late night television. So that was something that that first band that I put together for, you know, for the late show, the late night, it was called Late Night at that time. You know, all three of them were absolute maniacs when I hired them. And if I might say, you know, all three of them, Will, Steve, and Hiram, had reputations as being the most unreliable guys in town. I knew what I was getting into. Will, there's a famous story about Will Lee that he was going to play a show with Steve Kahn, the great jazz guitarist, at Carnegie Hall. And Will didn't show up, Will showed up an hour and a half late. They had to wait for him. But Will said, no problem. They went into overtime at golden time with the band, I mean, with the crew at Carnegie Hall. Will said, I'll just pay the overtime. That's the kind of guys that these guys were. And so I knew, you know, not like I didn't know what I was getting into, but, you know, what I'm getting to add is that Hiram, you know, eventually had to leave the band, was not, you know, the schedule of having to be there day in, day out, on time is a lot for a person, you know, a real creative kind of person like Hiram was. But we remained friends, and there was this time I'll never forget, and it may have taken place at, I have a feeling it took place at a club downtown that we used to go to, the Heartbreak. And Hiram was just starting to do his own gigs and get together his own band. And he said to me, yeah, he said, I'm sorry about what I put you through. Now that I'm starting to put my own thing together, I see what a leader has got to do. And, you know, I had no idea, you know. And I never forgot that. That was pretty big of him, pretty nice of him. He was a sweetheart of a guy and will be sorely missed, but he you know, thanks to his music, he has achieved immortality in his too short lifetime. Well, as far as the Cutting Room, a show, it was wonderful because it was, you know, all of his friends and musical compadres coming together to play his music. His music and music that he played that was associated with him. And everybody, so it was all his different bands and people from his different musical lives. And I was happy to be one of them. You know, his life as a television musician, who played with, nonetheless, James Brown in I think James's most historic appearance on Letterman, and one of his greatest appearances ever, right up there with some of his heavy appearances on Sullivan and stuff, and Shindig, because yeah, he played with Hiram, you know, my band featuring Hiram. He was, you know, when he heard Hiram start to play, he went, whoa, and gave Hiram a solo in one of the tunes. And Hiram knocked everybody out, including the godfather, James Brown. So we get there, we reminisce about that and play that song at that evening at the Cutting Room in Hiram's honor. Sex Machine, I think, or There Was a Time. No, There Was a Time, because James Brown, through his agent, asked us, what do you guys want to play with me? And Hiram said, There Was a Time. That guitar part, that's what I want to play with him. So we did. It became one of what became three songs, because the third song he did just because he heard us playing it and wanted to do it. But he did the first two songs. One of them was There Was a Time in honor of Hiram. And sure enough, he gave Hiram a solo and Hiram came through. So yeah, it was a heartfelt night at the Cutting Room in honor of Hiram Bullock.